first question is, who was number one most powerful female engineer?
The number one most powerful female engineer was a person from Microsoft who had done a lot of, she was actually in business, she'd done a lot of work in AI. So here's the real question. Does the world really think AI is more powerful than nuclear weapons?
Yeah, but actually, I will just add one comment then from the perspective of the recipient of that letter that Jill wrote. And first of all, to endorse the seriousness with which this is taken and the continuity of the work and the scale of the work is amazing. But actually, I have to say, I think, Jill, I'd suggest that reading the letters, there was a lot more emphasis maybe than I think came out in terms of lots and lots of problems that come up every year, and how those then get run to ground is really, I mean I could almost get the impression that okay, it's a nice letter and we can get by without testing, but in fact. Just about every system has found just something has come up of different natures, and also at the physics labs, often leading to the need for new simulations to worry about symmetries and other kinds of issues that might come up in the year. So I don't know if you want to add anything on that.
No, that's absolutely true. Any specific issue is not appropriate to discuss here, so I didn't dwell on it, but it's a very good point, and it's true.
And also for Sandia, and this kind of a natural symbiosis with Kansas City, manufacturing a lot of the things that you design.
Especially the early stage problems that we find.
Do you have any comments in terms of any issues of confidence in terms of, let's face it, I mean, they're designing materials for your safety systems that are completely different from what was in the original weapons, et cetera, do manufacturing processes. How do you do quality control to make sure you're not introducing new issues?
Yeah, well, I mean, we have a lot of engineers who live in Kansas City for the entire production runs, and so it's checked continuously. But we do expect, I mean, every system, every engineered system has problems at the beginning of, some things that come up at the beginning of life that the designers or the production agencies didn't see, and, you know, we try to prevent that. I'm confident we'll see it. The biggest issue is Kansas City. For those of you who know the complex at all, Kansas City was a very large plant. As a result of fewer weapons and wanting to make good use of money, it was downsized very significantly. And then the life extension programs came along, and Kansas City is having a hard time having the capacity, both people and space needed to do the production at the rate that is now required.
What we call it, right-sized.
Right-sized, yeah.
Anyway. questions?
Hi, thank you for coming and for inviting me. I'm Dan Leone. I'm a reporter with the Nuclear Security and Deterrence Monitor. Since you brought it up, the thought experiment, how long can we continue doing things the way we're doing them? And then parenthetically, if at the end of that time the answer isn't to build new weapons and retire old ones and perpetuate the cycle, what is the answer?
Yeah, it's a good question. Well, it depends on, you know, the policy at the time. So, you know, the labs don't do policy, they implement it. But it does seem, if there are fewer weapons, that actually just replacing all the parts, not necessarily new capabilities, but having a new weapon might not be a bad idea. If there are a lot of weapons still, or a lot now, I mean, we define as 1550. It just costs a lot. I mean, we just have to, that has to be traded off against all the other things needed in the defense. So we don't know. That the question, I didn't raise it. If I told you I thought we can only do this one more, you know, if I had said I thought we, you could only do this one more cycle, I would have meant it. I seriously raise it as a question we have to think about. Meadows last a long time, but you know, and other things, but at some point, and I think the real thought experiment is around reusing the physics package.
We'll start here and then go there.
Thank you. You mentioned the sort of human capital aspect of this and the importance of specialized, experienced folks. Can you talk a little bit about what's working and what's not working in terms of keeping motivation and morale quite high, especially as we have sort of aging workforce generally across federal government and labs?
Yeah, it's a great question and one we worry about a lot. I would just tell you, Sandia has come up with sort of a way to do this, which is pretty, which would have been considered 50, wouldn't have been considered 50 years ago. And the way we do it is we do a lot of work that isn't nuclear weapons work. And so, it's about 50-50. It's a little bit more now because the life extension programs are very active. So it's about 60% nuclear weapons, about 40% not. So the advantage of this for the lab is that engineers like to do stuff, really, really challenging state-of-the-art stuff, right? And so a lot of the programs that we do that aren't nuclear weapons are brand new designs and things nobody has done before, prototypes and things like that. And that excites a lot of people and they move around. And then the seriousness of sustaining and working a great deal on nuclear weapons can be done for part of their career or in and out. I tell you, I spent my career in the nuclear weapons program, out of the nuclear weapons program, in the nuclear weapons program, out of the nuclear weapons program, about 3 to 5 year cycles. And it worked great, you know, because you could bring new ideas, move ideas, and it works well for our workforce. The other labs have slightly different things that they do to motivate and attract people, but it is something we worry about all the time.
But it isn't the case that basically the non-weapons programs are the main recruitment conduit into the laboratory?
And science, and the science. A lot of people come, you know, early on, I did it too, work on science, and then you get exposed to the bigger laboratory and the weapons programs, and decide, yeah, I kind of want to do that too.
Dave Kramer, Physics Today. There seems to be some ambiguity in what you two are saying. On one hand, Ernie, you said that there's problems that come up with all the systems every year. And on the other hand, I've never heard a lab director say, we cannot assure the safety and reliability of the stockpile. So how do you explain that?
Well, anytime there is a problem, we work really hard to figure out what it is and fix it. And so there are things short of life extension programs that are proposed and funded to fix a problem that has significant implications. Oftentimes we find there are issues that come up, but that issue isn't pervasive. It's a result of how something was stored or handled, and that particular randomly selected weapon that we looked at. So it takes, we spend a lot of energy to resolve all those issues, and we fix them.
Yeah, and not every issue, by definition, because of the conclusion, would suggest that the reliability or safety are being compromised.
Yeah.
I think Paul, you had a question, then we'll come back.
Thank you. Thanks for having us. I think no matter where you are on the political spectrum, I think understanding this process is really important. And I just want to say one other thing about Dr. Hruby. I'm going to give you a shout out. You're way too humble, but you made a massive contribution to the annual certification process, bringing discipline and rigor. Not that it wasn't before, but you brought that to a whole new level. So I just want to compliment you on that.
Amen.
I just stick to certification. Lots of policy debates about new capability and putting nukes, maybe bringing back SLCM, a submarine launch cruise missile, using an existing warhead but putting it in a new environment. also mixing and matching, and we don't have the space constraints or the weight constraints and the missiles anymore, so you can have a maybe mix and match primary, mix and match primaries and secondaries, have a little more margin. How hard, I mean, so those are policy debates, but from a certification, what are the challenges around those kinds of changes to the stockpile?
Yeah, well, so taking an existing warhead and repackaging it into a new delivery vehicle, I think is only a little bit more challenging, but mixing primaries and secondaries, yeah, that's really gonna be, it's going to be hard to do the original designs. It's going to be really hard to do the certifications. And I'm not the expert on that. You know, the other labs are. But they are going to present new challenges. Yeah. It's a good question.
Paul, if I may take off on Paul. So Paul used the words more margin. Is not the way he used it necessarily, but is that a direction that you would think about going for answering the first question about 25 or 50 or 100 years? What about just kind of saying, okay, we'll put a little more margin in? And
can you explain that? A lot of folks in the room won't understand what that means.
Well, you know, it's an interesting thing about declaring how long something will last when you first build it, right? So we do all sorts of like accelerated aging tests and things like that, but obviously you can't get 25 years of aging before you put, I mean, the DOE might be slow, but we're not, it wasn't that slow. Right? And so in a way, the selection of lifetimes is dependent on how many spare parts you're gonna build, and it's dependent on your best science estimates. So you can over sort of like over design things. It has a set of problems and it buys you more margin. In fact, the safety system I talked about, I'd said, you know, they're good to 10 to the minus 3. Those things are always designed to 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5. I mean, we would never design them to just 10 to the minus 3 or even 2 times 10 to the minus 3, right? I mean, we try to buy a lot more margin so that if we find anything unexpected, it may still, and that is an approach that you could use as you start mixing and matching, especially.
That's not the safety margin, but what about the liability margin?
Yeah. Well, you know, these are really hard questions. I'm not going to.
Next question.
So this is closely related to the previous question. It was really interesting to see your note at the end about the uncertainty about how many more years can we continue this verification process, 25, 50, 100 years. And I'm curious to know, first of all, what is the nature of that conversation? Is it that all the experts in the field express a high degree of uncertainty, or is there some sort of polarized debate where there are two camps or three camps? And then the second piece of that is, what are the greatest drivers of uncertainty? Are there particular technical challenges that create the biggest open questions and uncertainty, or is it just the whole thing is very negative?
Right. Well, there are about 25,000 people in the NNSA laboratory, so there's about 25,000 opinions. But they probably do group in camps, and just due to some being, you know, some scientists and engineers wanting to be more conservative, why take a chance? Others saying, hey, I think we can understand the science, you know, things like that. But these camps are not created yet. This is a new issue. So, you know, if you went out there and said, hey, I understand there are camps, which one are you in? You get a blank look. It's a new issue. And it's an issue again, I think is largely driven by, to the last part of your question, the physics package. So do you think plutonium ages? Do you think it will age in 50 years? Do you think it might age in 100 years? Do you think, are you like comfortable saying 150? You know, 103? And I think this is actually now the debate, and it still requires a lot of science. So just, you know, data is collected on plutonium today, not by underground testing, but in other ways in the laboratory without nuclear yield. And they're compared to zero-timed underground tests. And then you say, has it changed? That's a hard problem. There's just a lot of debate about each little part of that problem, and then it causes you to say, when do we say we're not sure? So far, we haven't.
Just to say the obvious, I mean, I think the answer to those questions is very important for our business here
right.
at NTI.
Yes, it is. I totally agree.
Deb and Jack, we're kind of move across here.
Yeah, thank you again, Jill, for your presentation. When we think about this, we focus a lot on what's happening in our U.S. lab systems, and we tend to be at risk of mirror imaging when we think about other nuclear weapon states. And I'm wondering, based on your experience, if you could talk a little bit about your impressions of the other nuclear weapon states' approach to this and the degree to which there is information flowing back and forth between the nuclear weapon states.
Did Senator Nunn ask you to ask this question?
No.
this was his big question. I think he had to drop off. But let's see. Safety, the U.S. has generally considered the way we do safety as unclassified. But not necessarily reliability and all the other things, right? And definitely not security, highly classified. Now we have not had significant dialogues, weapon lab to weapon lab, about many of these issues. The one place where there was very good joint science done was in plutonium aging, when we were talking to one another. In general, we don't know a lot about the detailed processes used. We probably know more about Russia than any place else. We are probably more concerned about Pakistan and others than any place else. But the details, we just simply don't know. We've not had that kind of exchange.
But in the late 90s, there was this specific weapon safety exchanges.
There were specific weapon safety exchanges with Russia.
That was my question also.
That was your question.
Yeah. Okay. It's a good question, and I wish I had a better answer. Yeah.
Hi. Thanks for your talk. One question I had was about the introduction of new processes in production. So everything from additive manufacturing to new pyroprocessing techniques for different materials that are meant to increase efficiency and reduce footprint in all these aging nuclear facilities. Coming from your perspective at ADA, how does that sit with you in terms of what it means for overall certification?
My answer might surprise you, but I'm a big fan of new processes as long as we do everything we need to do to certify in the beginning, because we just can't keep these old processes that we use that would be so archaic. And again, how do you attract the best manufacturing engineers? I know you know this. If you say we're going to do things like we did 50 years ago. So I'm a big fan, but I think that just means that you have to have a lot of process, and it adds cost to life extension programs.
So, Jill, I just wanted to go back to the conversation that we were having about how long can weapons last. And there is, among some of the advocates for the ban treaty, the nuclear ban treaty, a suggestion that we could just let these things sit. Mm-hmm. And if they become less capable over time, then that is a form of disarmament, or it leads in a direction towards disarmament. What's wrong with that belief?
Yeah, well, first, even if they're just sitting, you have to assess their safety. And in fact, I failed to say that in addition to the seven weapon systems, there's actually one other weapon system that we assess the safety of, which is the W84, which is which is still around, but we're not intending to, so we have to assess that. We don't assess its reliability because it's not part of this, but we do have to assess its safety. And oh, by the way, you find things. And you have to address them. And people say, we don't want to spend money on, what's your choice? So I think that's part of the issue, is that not everything will age gracefully. And certainly we have no idea about other nations' nuclear weapons stockpiles aging gracefully.
Is Pantex running pretty much flat out in terms of dismantlement?
And yeah, and everything else.
That's fine. I think it's a great presentation. One of the confounding aspects of managing a system like this is that the Congress on an annual basis gets to change it. Mm-hmm. And so even if testing were resumed, you'd still have to run the system on the assumption that the political system could withdraw testing at any time. So is that the reality, that this mechanism that's been developed for safety and reliability and of the weapons systems likely to continue no matter what?
Yes, that's a good question. The truth is, this assessment process for old weapons is right whether or not you're testing. And we didn't have it before because the whole environment was just different. We were building new things. There were lots of them. We were testing. It was all pretty empirical. We felt confident. But this is a new reality of old weapons. It would take decades. And it would be a bad idea to recreate the old system in its entirety. If the president said we have to do a test, we certify that we can get that done pretty quickly. But to recreate a system that was fully dependent on testing of that nature, that's another issue than can you do a test.
Well, I'm not even saying fully dependent. I'm saying it would be a matter of indifference.
Yeah, you would do it. Yeah, it's a good point.
It's a political difference.
It is
not a scientific one.
Thank you so much.
Could you briefly touch on the and more that you said you couldn't include? I know we don't have time for a whole other lecture, but as much as we may want one.
Well, one of the things that I wanted to talk about, because I think it's not well understood, is just how the DOE labs fit into the overall system of R&D in the United States. Very, very briefly, they're federally funded research and development centers, and there are 42, I believe, FFRDCs. Some of them are associated with science and technology, and most of the science and technology ones are the DOE labs. And so the labs serve a big purpose in this country. And the DOE labs include labs, Office of Science labs, the NNSA labs, and a few others. It really is, from my experience at the labs and traveling around, the most respected R&D complex in the world. And these three labs just happen to do, nuclear weapon design, but the other labs are also very, very fine labs. And we should be very proud of the system this country created.
I just wanted to note that this whole assessment process was something that grew out of, as you pointed out in your first slide, the CTBT, the negotiation of the comprehensive test ban. And we, interestingly tonight, as I look around, have a few veterans of the Clinton administration here tonight who were instrumental in facilitating that process, and in particular, who innovated this assessment process as a mechanism for getting first agreement within the executive branch to pursue a zero yield test ban, but also with the Congress. This was something that was important for, well, we're not at ratification yet,
but I love this picture. This is actually him signing the test ban treaty. Look at the document.
Yeah.
Comprehensive. thanks, Joan, because it's a really good point. I actually went back and got the
veterans in the room.
Oh, that would be wonderful.
Steve Andreasen deserves a lot of credit for this assessment process. And Charlie Curtis, who played a leadership role in this process.
But the documents about the assessment are incredibly good. I went back and read them actually preparing for this, and they're just excellent and set the stage for really what has become a very, a respectable process.
Yeah, I'll just make a comment first and then we'll get to you, but since you raised CDBT, obviously, in 1999, there was the bit of a fiasco in terms of the congressional, the Senate, I should say, evaluation of the treaty. First, I'll say that there was a lot of consternation about that, and particularly about the lab directors and their presentations. But I think, frankly, the lab directors were being honest. We did not have this program yet to be able to certify. However, the two major objections technically were, okay, we didn't have science-based stockpile stewardship, as far as I can tell. Looks like we sure have it right now. And we didn't have the global seismic monitoring system. We have it now. What conclusion would you draw from those two statements?
Well, I will just say, I have to be honest about this. Paul Robinson and I have spent countless hours. Paul was a former lab director. He was not in favor of the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty and testified so. Paul would tell you, if he were here, that how can we say the stockpile stewardship program is working? That all we know is somebody jumped out of a 100-story building, and at the 50th floor, they're saying, it seems pretty good right now. That's an exact quote. So
I believe there is a mechanism in the treaty for addressing that question.
So some of these issues so we have a lot of work to do in convincing, some of the people who were concerned then, they remain concerned. And to Paul's credit, he would always send me the publications that weren't going to support CTBT the day that they were going to appear in public and saying, I hope this doesn't make your life too difficult, right? But there are still differences of opinion, including among former lab directors.
Question here.
Thank you very much for your very insightful presentation. I was just about to ask about the question of CTBT, a little different perspective. But what would be implications of the future uncertainty of the SSP for CTBT, the future prospect of U.S. ratification of the CTBT? Because some people suggest that the only possible way forward for the U.S. ratification could be to change the duration of the CTBT from indefinite period to certain period, like 15 or 20 years, because of this very issue of the uncertainty in the future of the SSP. So so that's my question. Thanks.
Yeah. Well, I'll just go back to the things that Charlie said here for a second. In reality, from the lab perspective, we have to assume that we're going to have to certify without testing for I mean, even if it came back, even if there was a test for some reason that you would not then change your assessment approach necessarily. This idea, I can't predict politics. I do think that if you said CTBT for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, that some of the technical skeptics would be satisfied. Whether the political skeptics would be satisfied, I don't know. And I don't, so I, it, it's, that's just outside of what I can predict. But it's to the point of I'm on the 50th, I'm passing the 50th floor, and you know, so far so good. So the technical skeptics still wanna say, at some point we might need to, but the technical skeptics never win the day on the political, I mean, political discussion.
Steve, you want to comment on the treaty?
Well, just on the question of duration, in brief, I mean, the Clinton administration in 1995 had two crucial issues to address with respect to CTBT, and one was the issue of duration, because in 1993, the president signed a presidential decision directive committing to a CTBT of limited duration. And that decision was changed, but it wasn't changed simply in the context of CTBT in the spring of 1995. It was changed in the context of seeking the indefinite extension of the NPT, which was crucial in 1995. So the international community would rightly view this as the ultimate bait and switch, or at least some would, if now CTBT, which was crucial to NPT extension, you know, all of a sudden was changed in the context of our commitment to CTBT. So it would be, you know, as Ernie pointed out, I mean, the stewardship program and the certification process is all built on the foundation of CTBT and the president's commitment in 1993 to pursue that. But even the CTBT commitment was integrally tied to the NPT, which is really the cornerstone. So you start pulling on some of these strings and things start happening.
Yeah, good, thank you.
And in reverse, if there were a CTBT ratification, it would sure give a lot of head, tailwind to the NPT.
Yeah. It sure would.
Well, just an added comment about the CTBT. Just an added comment about if you read the CTBT, it has the standard provision that would allow you to withdraw from the agreement if you confronted serious issues, supreme national interest type of thing. So the treaty itself is the fact that it's of indefinite duration just puts it in the same camp as many other arms control agreements. And once the United States did withdraw from an agreement, namely the ABM treaty, which had a similar provision, it shows that it can, if necessary, be done.
And that's the 50th floor answer. Okay, are there any more questions? It's obviously been a very interesting and stimulating presentation, for which we thank you, Jill. And if not, then we're going to thank Jill again and adjourn to the lobby.